Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. Welcome to First Christian Church at Kennett. Glad you've joined us this morning on Facebook Live. We have a few other guests here this morning. Robin Bird will be our worship leader. We have Suzanne on the organ. We have the Dalton girls. Is it the Dalton girls or the Dalton gang?
Girls,
Dalton girls, and we got Gary back there keeping the seat warm, and our every week camera person is Lori. I have a few announcements for you, and I hope if you have children this week, you can have your kids turn on to the Wow VBS. That will be on our Facebook Live site. Where you are right now, and it'll be Monday through Thursday at 2 o'clock. And each session will last about 35 minutes, and if we can figure it out, we may actually be able to talk to your kids afterwards and just reinforce the lesson. So that's Monday through Thursday at 2 o'clock. Meals for Mindy Brown. As many of you know, Mindy is recuperating from her knee surgery, replacement surgery. If you would like to help out with meals, please contact Suzanne, who is coordinating those meals. Still in the hospital as of this morning is Michael Holston. Michael had a long rod placed in his spine this week and did develop an infection and has a fever, so keep him in your thoughts and prayers. We ask prayers for Callie Roberts, who is in hospice. This is Suzanne's sister. Also continue to pray for Randy Carter. He's getting a little bit stronger every day. Pray for Ken Dye, who has a couple of leaky heart valves and is a little weak. And pray for Steve Bolin, this is Sonny's father, who recently had surgery. Does anybody else have an announcement? If not, let us listen to our beautiful prelude this morning.
Happy Father's Day to everyone. Please join me in the call to worship. Welcome. This is a time to celebrate and worship God who loves us.
We are grateful and thankful for all God's blessings in our lives.
We gather to remember that Christ gave his life for us.
We humbly praise God for such a gift.
Come, friends. Come and worship the God of love and hope.
Praise be to God at all times and in all places. Amen.
And our opening hymn this morning is number 86, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let us pray. Holy God, who created all that exists, we praise you. We open our hearts and our spirits this day to your eternal love and forgiving mercy. Be with us as we participate in this worship service. Remind us again that Jesus Christ gave his life that we might fully understand the depth and breadth of your love. We pray together as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now it's time for the children's sermon.
All right. Welcome, kids. Today, as you probably know, hopefully my kids will figure it out sometime later today, Today is Father's Day, and today is the day we honor our fathers. And I've talked about my dad to you before. Maybe you didn't know, but my dad gave me this really nice stole, I don't know, maybe 15 years ago. And on one side, it's kind of cool because I could just flip it over. But it's got pictures of children on it. And then on the other side, it's got pictures of all of the animals that went onto Noah's Ark. And I think it's pretty cool. And, you know, we all have some things that our dad has taught us that we want to make sure we always remember. My dad passed away just a little over a month ago. And as I think about the things that he taught me, some of them are kind of silly things. Not so silly. I love baseball, and I got that from my dad. I love baseball and basketball. I got that from my dad. He taught me that. He also taught me proper manners, like when sitting at the table, you know, not to burp, and if you do, you say, excuse me. So hopefully if you burp at the table, or theoretically any place else, just say, excuse me. He taught me to keep my elbows off the dining table when I'm eating. Let's see, what else did he teach me? Anybody else? What did your dad teach you?
Do your best.
How to play tennis. Dalton girls, your dad teach you anything?
Bunch of history.
Yeah, my dad didn't teach me a whole lot about history. But one of the things he taught me was when I made mistakes, and if I was willing to learn from my mistake, I would quickly be forgiven, no matter how big a mistake that was. My dad was also a big supporter of the things that I did in my life. I remember the first time I preached when I was 15 years old, and my dad was there. And when I fell miserably on my face after that, my dad was there while I was crying to give me comfort. And then throughout the years, my dad has traveled great distances to hear me preach and to meet my churches. And in fact, he was here 9 months ago in this church, and maybe you remember that. So on this day, think about your fathers. And if you can, show a special love to your fathers by either giving a gift or writing a card or just saying, Dad, thank you for being my dad. Let us pray. God, we thank you for all of our fathers, our biological fathers, our adopted fathers, our grandfathers, uncles that have acted as fathers to us, foster parents that have been there for us. We thank you, God, for these men who have taught us certain things in life that are important and help us to always honor our fathers as well as our mothers. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I did not. The flowers are from Suzanne, and she told me they're oak leaf
hydrangeas.
Will you now please bow with me as we go to God in prayer? God of springtime and summer, fall and winter, we thank you, O God, that you have given us such a beautiful creation to live under, to play under, to gather together when we can. We thank you, O God, that you have given us people with such great gifts, the gift of music, which inspires us. We thank you, God, that you give others the gift of being able to heal those, our doctors and nurses, our hospitals, our nursing homes. And as they are under such great pressure these days, O God, we pray that your compassion and love will fill those places where they work, that they might find a brief moment of respite in turning to you for guidance, for faith, for wisdom, and for hope. We lift up to you, O God, in silence, those who we are praying for this day. We pray for our nation, that our leaders might guide us, that we might have unity. And where there is hate and discord, may we find ways to sow love. Be with us as a church, O God, as we contemplate coming back together soon. Help us to rely upon your wisdom and not our anxiousness. Gift our leaders at this church with wisdom and understanding of figuring out what is best for God's people. Help us, O God, in this period to realize that while we may create some distance between ourselves and others, but help us to break down the barriers. Help us to pick up phones, make phone calls. Help us to make meals for others, to write cards and letters to those who need to hear from us. We love you, O God, and we thank you for all that you do for us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This is Father's Day, and it's remarkable to gather at this table and to think of a father's love. Some of us, maybe most of us, had fathers that would do anything for us. I know my father was willing to lay down his life for his family and even for his country. But to think about the remarkable impact that this sacrifice has, God coming to earth in the form of a child, to make that sacrifice for all, to show us that love, to join us in our suffering. What a beautiful meaning the cross is for us on this Father's Day. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this bread and this cup, a reminder of your constant love for all humankind. Help us, O God, as we take this bread and drink this cup, to remember not only the sacrifice that Christ has made and that you have made, but also for the sacrifice that you call us to make, to take up the cross and follow you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread. And after he blessed it, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat, every one of you, for this is my body, which is broken for you." In a like manner, after the supper, Jesus took a cup of wine. And after he blessed it, he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and drink, every one of you, for this is the blood of my new covenant, which is poured out for you." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim our Lord's death until he comes. This morning's scripture reading, continuing on in the book of Genesis, where I'll land this summer. Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 through 21. And I've never preached from this text before. In fact, I love to jump over this text. It makes me uncomfortable. And when the Bible makes you uncomfortable, it may be saying, you might want to read this. So we're going to read this morning, even if it makes us uncomfortable. So the child here is Isaac. He grew, and he was weaned. And Abraham made a great feast on that day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to her husband Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." This matter was very distressing to the father, Abraham, on account of his son Ishmael. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she is told. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a great nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Now, one of the things I love most about the Old Testament is it's willing to tell these really uncomfortable stories about those people who are supposed to be the heroes. Oftentimes, it shows our heroes in a bad light, and it's willing to air out the family's dirty laundry for all to see, especially, you know, the terrible flaws of heroes like Abraham and Sarah and David and Solomon. And, you know, I could name more people who had serious flaws, but they are our heroes. These are people that God uses to do great things in spite of their flaws. And while the New Testament writers oftentimes praise Abraham, by our modern moral compass, he is a dirty, rotten scoundrel, and his wife is no better, if not worse. Now, you might remember, Abraham and Sarah had given up
on God's promise. God had promised them when they were younger that he would make of them a great nation and that their descendants would be greater than the sands of the beach. And by the time Sarah was about 80 or so years old, she gave up hope. And so she decided she would take matters into her own hands. You know, sometimes, I don't know about you, but I sometimes do give up on God's plan because it's just not happening fast enough. And so I just take matters into my own hands. And that's what she did. And so she looked at her husband, Abraham, who's 90 years old. And she says, you know what, Abraham, we need a child and we need it fast. And I'm not able to do that for you. So take my slave girl. She's much younger. She's very pretty, by the way. And take her and have a child with her. And then we can have a child. And we'll just take that child away and raise it as our own. And, you know, Abraham says, okay, which is what most men say to their wives when she tells them to do something. Now, we don't know if Hagar consented. It's not said whether she did or not. But we do know Abraham obeys his wife. And sadly, from the moment that that happens, when Abraham takes Hagar and knows her, from that moment on, Sarah looked at Hagar with disdain, and she was very cruel and abusive to her slave girl. And now her slave girl is pregnant. And the slave girl, Hagar, runs off into the wilderness. And it's while she is in the wilderness that she begins to wonder, where is my future now? I don't have a place to go. I'm no longer in my home area. And God sees her. And God says to Hagar, Hagar, I have a plan for you, but you need to go back. You need to go back to Abraham and Sarah. And you will name this child Ishmael, which means God hears, God listens. So Abraham took the young Ishmael under his wing, as any father would do. And he raised the child as his own, because it was his own flesh and blood. He taught him how to hunt with a bow. He taught him how to read the stars at night, to follow the night sky so that they wouldn't get lost in the vast desert. He taught him about things that all boys need to know, like how to use the remote control and other important things to know, like how to burp, but when. Now, as you recall, you know the story, Abraham and Sarah finally, about 10, 12 years later, she gets pregnant and she has a child. At the ripe old age, Abraham's 100, she's 90. And they name the child Isaac, which means laughter, because Sarah laughed when she was told she would be pregnant. And then 2 or 3 years later, after Isaac's been born, Isaac is weaned from his mother. And like parents who always want to throw a celebration for their child, they have a post-weaning party. And I don't know what was served at that, but my imagination's just going wild. Now, during the party, Sarah sees Ishmael playing with Isaac. And the text is unclear. Were they merely playing together, or was Isaac teasing the child? I'm sorry, was Ishmael teasing Isaac? Some translators say this 12, 14-year-old boy was mocking the toddler. Now, Sarah becomes irate, not because Ishmael is mocking or playing with Isaac. She becomes irate because she finally realizes, it finally clicks, when she sees the two boys together, which one is due the inheritance. You see, back in that culture, that ancient culture, it was the oldest child of the father that would receive the inheritance, and it was up to that child to split the inheritance with his brother or not. And Isaac, she thought, Sarah thought, he should get all of the inheritance. And so she says to her husband, Abraham, who, remember, always obeys. She says, get rid of my slave girl and that son of yours. Send them out into the desert so that my child, Isaac, will receive 100% of the inheritance. Now, likely, they would die in the desert. And Abraham, feeling terrible about it, goes ahead and does it by giving them a loaf of bread and a canteen of water. Do you see what I mean when I say Abraham and Sarah can be scoundrels? In the wilderness, Ishmael falls flat on his face, probably due to the hot desert sun. And I'm wondering if maybe he is feeling dehydration because he gave most of the water to his mother to care for her. She sees him fall, and she knows he's about to die. So she drags him under a tree. And then she goes about 75 yards off to weep and to cry because she cannot bear to see her son die. And it is there again that God sees her, that God sees Hagar, and God hears Ishmael crying. Now, this begs for me a question. It's just a theological question. Why does God allow this to happen? Does God care about those who are suffering? When Hagar first escaped from Sarah, why did God tell her to go back if this is how the story is going to end up with Ishmael dying in the desert? Why would God send her and Ishmael out into the desert only for Hagar to see him die? I don't have an easy answer. In fact, I wrestle with the answer. Weeping and then screaming, God, for who knows how long, she screams to God. God finally breaks the silence. And God says to her, I see you and I hear you. Do not be afraid. Then God wipes away her tears. And God brushes back her hair and leads her over to the boy, Ishmael, who is on his last breath. And then God, it says, opened her eyes and points to her where there was a fountain of water nearby, about 50 yards away. God gives Hagar the strength to carry Ishmael to the water. God had made the promise to Hagar just as he had to Abraham and Sarah. And it was God who would bless Ishmael with many children, in fact, 12 sons, and would make of them a great nation, the Arab nation. These stories are hard for us to fathom because they leave us with these unanswered questions that I raised before, and sometimes they fill us with anger because when I read the story again, I have anger towards Abraham not standing up to his wife and Hagar treating her slave girl the way she did. Why must Sarah be so abusive to Hagar? Why was there slavery? Why did Abraham do what his wife told him to do, casting out his firstborn son and the mother of that child into the wilderness where they would die? And there would be no one to care for Hagar. She was on her own, not a place for an ancient woman to be. And the most critical question for me that theologians ask themselves all the time, why does an all-powerful and loving God allow this to happen? Which leads me to ask some modern questions. Why in the greatest nation on earth that we live in? Why is there violence? Why is there racism and inequality? Why isn't, you know, justice not equal for all? Why doesn't God just straighten things out? And I mean, I scream that from time to time, I do. Why can't churches work together to bring about changes and take down barriers and stand with those who need someone to stand for them and point them to the water? Why are churches so segregated? Now, when the situations of the world leave us on edge, ranting and raving and showing our fists to God, crying out for justice and liberty and freedom and compassion for all people, God sees us and God hears us. And I would like to think that God wipes away our tears, and that God comforts us and encourages, do not give up hope. And then God points us to the water, which is cool and refreshing, and we are strengthened to walk the rest of this journey. That's really the challenge, is it not? Not giving up. It's so easy to give up. When we give up, we close ourselves off to the rest of the world, pretend as if that's not my problem, that's not my deal, and we don't see the suffering and the dying. And if we see it, we said it's not my fault, it's not my problem. Or we say, I'm just one person, what can I do? That's what despair looks like. I give up. I can't do it. There's nothing I can do about it. It's like being in the barren desert, feeling deserted. Yet this is what I believe. God sees and God hears, not from a distance, but from right here in our midst. God is wanting to do a new thing in our community, in our nation, in our world, if only we would join with God to bring about the necessary changes and to do it in such a way that gives people hope and meaning. All of the chaos, all of the violence, all of the suffering and the division, that's not on God. That's on us. It's even on us when we choose inaction. But when we listen to God and when we act faithfully, God's promises are fulfilled. But when we decide to join God, when we decide God just doesn't get it, we muck things up and we decide we'll just do it on our own. And we'll take matters into our own hands and we'll become divisive and angry and bitter and violent. That's what happens when we take matters into our own hands instead of trusting God. Sarah didn't need to take things into her own hands when God said he would give her a child, but she gave up on God and she twisted her husband to do a terrible thing. And then Sarah has the audacity to be abusive to Hagar. Sarah doesn't need to be ruthless to Hagar and Ishmael. For God has promised that Isaac would be the inheritor. So what does God do? God sees and he hears Hagar and Ishmael. And God protects them and God makes of them a great nation. All Hagar needed to do was open up her eyes and go to where God was pointing her to go. There is water in the desert if you know how to find it, if you know where to look. And there is water for us and for our nation if only we will open our eyes and go into the direction that God is leading us.
God has given you all that you will need as you reach out in love and caring to others. Go into God's world bringing the good news of redemption and hope. In Jesus' name, go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you always. Amen.